And we're back, ladies and gentlemen, live on the Philippe Matthew Show. Thank you for tuning in wherever you are around the world. Of course, one of my most favorite scholars and laureates is back with me today, Professor Kaba Hiawatha Kamene, star of Hidden Colors 1 through 4 and the latest fifth edition of the 1804 Hidden History of Haiti. Also the star of upcoming film by Amadeus Christ, Heavy as the Crown. Look forward to that. We're going to be doing a massive amount of promotions on that to make sure the world gets that film. He's the author of Honoring William Leo Hansberry, and I have known this man only a short period of time, but I have known him long enough to call him a friend. Welcome back, my friend.
Hotep, my brother Philippe, thank you so much for this opportunity. It's so it's so different to be doing something live at this time on this day, you know. So I mean, it's just you know, like you know, when you do first time, it sort of kind of stretches you to another level. So I appreciate you stretching me to this level to make me look at things differently. And just to give a point to the Outer Darkness, Heavy as the Crown piece, I spoke to Brother Amadeus Christ the other day, and Amadeus was interesting because the conversation between Amadeus and myself, as I've spoken to you behind the scenes and just in our conversations, religions is the type of, for me, was the type of experience that I got so deep in the learning process that the writing of the actual book itself sort of kind of took a back seat to a certain point. Not that it wasn't there, but it's just that I was so enthralled and entranced with the level of spirituality that our people were involved in and what they did. And then looking at the masterpiece that Tariq Nasheed has put together on the hidden history of the Haitian Revolution of 1804, spirituality was just all up in the ether for me these past couple of days. I spoke to Amadeus the other day, and I was explaining to him, and he was, you know, he had a few questions. He's at that point now where he's putting things together to finalize the film. And he asked me if I would share some material with him on the Shabaka stone, and which I did. And Amadeus reached back out to me about a day or two, in fact, it was yesterday. And he said that he was so taken back by the level of spiritual, almost the same thing I'm saying to you is what he said. In fact, wow. Maybe I'm just repeating what he told me that I was thinking myself. So he said that he actually has to do spirituality before religions in two parts. Because he wants to meet his deadline that he said in 18. But at the same time, he said that the depth of African spirituality, which is universal spirituality, is so deep and so powerful. It is a place where so many of us are not there, but we are there. We just don't see what's in the room.
Right, right.
People who are deep into religions, people who go through so many different experiences are actually having an African experience, but because Europeans have superimposed their religious dogma, essence of it. And so what I'm hoping my book will do, and what I'm hoping that Amadeus Christ's book, a video will do, documentary, Heavy as the Crown will do in its two parts, it will allow people of all religions, of all backgrounds, to be able to celebrate the depth of their spirituality within the religion that they practice. Mm-hmm. In fact, the religion may fall away and the spirituality may take its place.
Right.
Because they will see the success of spirituality, living a spiritual life,
yes,
and not a religious life.
Absolutely.
Because what we're experiencing now, Brother Philippe, as you see in so many religions, people are claiming to be so religious, but they act so devilish.
Isn't that something?
How
Isn't
can you do something? That?
Right.
You know, your holy book tells you something. There's only one way to read a book in whatever language it comes in. How can you conduct yourself so irreligiously yet claim to be so religious?
Right.
So if you peel away that religion, which really is the religion is the vocalization of spirituality, and ritual and ceremony is the actual practice of through speech what's deep within. So cut away the ritual ceremony, cut away your speaking of, and just be spiritual.
Yes, yes.
And that's what, but I just wanted to add that since you had spoken about Amadeus and Heavy is the Crown. Heavy is the Crown gonna be heavier it's, than the Crown.
Man, of course, I just absolutely love and adore Amadeus. I call him my son. And not because he's mine, but because he shines. I know he's watching. You know, when Out of Darkness was just like unbelievable. It was a 3-hour epic of our story. And it was radically different than Hidden Colors. It was, you know, it's Out of Darkness, and what Amadeus does is in a genre unto itself. And so Heavy, so now I know for a fact that he's got, because you know his background in graphics and sound design and editing is absolutely off the chain. So I know this one has cinematically is even more impactful. Excuse me. And so we were talking, and I was saying, look, dude, we've got to just absolutely make this a worldwide phenomenon and tag it with what Professor Kaba is doing on spirituality before religions. And, you know, one of the things that keeps coming back to me in terms of just logic and common sense, and, you know, we've done a lot of shows on this, you and I. We've had many of your peers on, with Professor Smalls, and we just had Dr. Wade Nobles on yesterday, and many others. And the thing that keeps coming back to me, and then we'll talk about Hapi, but actually it's kind of, we're kind of moving in that direction anyway. But one of the things that keeps coming back to me is the fact, Dr. David Imhotep, of course, first means first. If we were the first to populate this planet, and you talked about, we did a private class, you and I, that we're going to be releasing later this year with the first metaphysical and comedic virtual wisdom school. You were talking about melanin and carbon, and it was absolutely amazing that everything comes from black, everything comes from Africa, everything starts with us. And then the European showed up, maybe 20,000 years ago, but we've been here hundreds of thousands of years. And so it just doesn't make sense to me. Why would I follow someone that came after me? That doesn't make sense to me. Why would I would want to be connected to that original frequency, to my original people, to my original divine, whatever that connection was, whatever that Shabaka stone, Pharaoh Shabaka was writing in stone about his ancestors. That's the frequency that we should be tuning into. But we have allowed, if you will, this newcomer, our children, to disrupt that frequency. And so now we're following our children versus following our leader. And I don't know why that sometimes seemingly is so difficult for us to grasp.
It's just very interesting, my brother. You know, the point that you make is well taken. And I know that the one thing that Amadeus told me was that, to put it in perspective, he said, Out of Darkness One was practice for what he's about to present now. And from when I first spoke to that brother, he's a genius. He's this next generation coming up. He's just an absolute genius. He's a wonderful father. He's a wonderful person. He is just someone who lives what he speaks. And in this day and age, it's so wonderful to meet young people who are there. Mm-hmm. And I am just very happy to be a part of what it is that his generation is ushering in. And I know that just my own experience with writing this book, it's been a long time in coming, and I realize that.
Yeah.
But again, like I say, spirituality is the type of thing that you don't rush. You know,
right.
You don't rush the creator.
Sure. Sure.
And just as I'm speaking of the Creator, I believe and I feel that he has used me, because she realizes that what I will put on, where I'm to all backgrounds, because you see, as you say about why would you follow the child, the real question is all cultures should be following this. Because Africa is the parent of all cultures.
That's correct.
And it's just this sociological thing we call, what we call white fragility, that your guest was able to introduce to us as a term used as opposed to white supremacy. The idea of fragility, you know, so that it's important that as we move forward and we look at this, this is a time for us as a human family worldwide to begin to make decisions as to where we want this world to go. Yeah. Because one of the most important things to realize, studying ecology and geology, anthropology and archaeology, not an expert in any area, but I have a dabbling of enough to understand what I'm about to tell you, I realize, and that is that there is no reason why the human family has to continue on this earth. You know, the earth don't need us. And that's very important to understand, because just like it brought us in, it can and will take us out as a people. And if we start acting ridiculous with these bombs and these guns and these violence, we will destroy ourselves, and the earth will just say, well, we tried, but
we'll start over again. Yeah.
So panspermia, which is the ever-present enlivening and fertilizing force in the cosmic universe, will just go elsewhere and try to project again. Or maybe return back to the original place where it started and let the folk know that brought us here. They just weren't ready. We tried, and it was a valiant try, but they went north. And them people should have stayed in Africa. They shouldn't have gone north and froze their pineal gland, because when they did that, they lost their spirituality. And when they lost their spirituality, they came back on their own people, their own family members, and attempted to destroy them because they had a fragile nature of insecurity and inferiority. So there is no reason, just as the dinosaurs once dominated the earth for over 166 million years, what we call those types of reptiles, I'm afraid of dinosaurs, but let's just, because it means terrible lizard, but let's just go with what we call those living forces that dominated the planet. Whatever size they may have been, I don't know. I'm not even going to get there. But there was something that lived for 166 million years, and within a flash of an eye, they were taken off. And they became the mammals that allowed themselves to perfect themselves, because the terrible lizards weren't around anymore. So out of the trees, these mammals came. And these mammals began to perfect themselves in the tree. And then pretty soon, one of the mammals that was in the tree came down on the earth. And it began to form itself into this perfect masterpiece that we call humanity. But just like the dinosaurs, there's no reason for us. The earth is sacred, and it will be here.
Good point.
But
good point.
There is no reason why we have to stay. So if we start getting cute and start acting stupid and start killing on each other and start doing all the things that the great Creator did not want. Creator means to create, not destroy. But to have a creator, you must have a destroyer. And given humanity's free will, we had a free will to say no to love and respect and honor, integrity, respect, balance, and harmony. So we keep saying no, nature will tell us no.
Exactly, exactly.
And they'll just clock us out. And they won't even have to clock us out, because we're going to clock ourselves out.
No doubt. Well, you know, talking about this in terms of everything coming from Africa, everything that we know about history, humanity, comes from Africa. And one of the central units of Africa is the Nile Valley River. And I'm sure my audience knows, because I have a brilliant audience. But for those who are watching that might be new coming on, walk us through why the Nile Valley River, Hapi River, is such a major force in the evolution of our humanity. And then we'll get into this, because I want you to tell the story to the people about how you created this Hapi oil, which is absolutely amazing. Where is mine? I got to find mine. It's amazing. but I put it on, and Yolanda, you know, it. Trust me, we won't go there. But you know what'll happen. So anyway, let's talk about the Hapi oil. I mean, the Hapi River, and why is it so significant? And I'm sorry, I've got a chest cold, ladies and gentlemen, so I'm under the weather. So if I sound a little berry whitish, don't take offense. So talk to us about Hapi Nile Valley River, and why is it so important to us to know about this, but particularly to our children?
Well, you know, and again, it goes back into the development of the Hapi oil. Mm-hmm. And so you'll understand it in its totality, but to step back to the class and to look at the phenomenon of our earth, it's important to understand when you said everything comes out of the black, it becomes important how our earth was developed. And our earth was through our star, the sun, throwing off pieces of itself. And again, I don't want to get into the more advanced research as it relates to planets. I just want to deal with what we learn in school so that we can be clear. Mm-hmm. I don't want to talk about the fact that Pluto is not a planet, so there's really only eight. I don't want to talk about the 12 planets that people say exist. I realize that, but I want to just talk about the planets being thrown off. And according to when they were thrown off, determine how far away from the planet they are. So we would only imagine that it is possible that the elder children are the ones furthest from the sun. Mm-hmm. And as you get closer to the sun, to Mercury, Mercury is the youngest. The third planet from the sun, the third world, is the Earth. Mm-hmm. Because of the nature of the relationship of the sun to the Earth, and because of what would later become the tilt of the 23 and a third degree of the Earth on its axis, that it's rotation on a 23 and a third degree, along with the revolution around the sun, created the appearance of the sun at various parts of the earth, 365.25, what we call times, which we call days. Mm-hmm. Now, days out in on Jupiter are much longer than they are on the earth. Mm-hmm. Days in Mercury are much shorter than they are on the Earth, because you're dealing with the rotation of each planet on its axis as it relates to the appearance of the sun on the Earth. So when it's sunlight on one part of the Earth, it's nighttime on another part of the Earth. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. When the Earth rotates, as it revolves around, the part that was in nighttime becomes daytime, and the part that was in daytime becomes nighttime. Because of the nature of the position of the earth and the hottest and most direct rays of the sun, it focused on what we call the equator. Mm-hmm. In particular, that part of the earth that we today call the Great Lakes region. Now, the part of the hill, there was a war on the earth. At first, when all of the various planets came from the sun, they were all gaseous balls because the sun is a gas. And so in interstellar space, there's a coolness. And in the balance of the coolness to the heat of the gaseous state, inside of the earth, in its core, it began to get hard. It began to get the core of the earth to become very hard. And in this hardness, it created events that could be earthquakes and volcanoes. Mm-hmm. That we're still experiencing today. But in the early days, there was no earth. There was no land that was above the sun. Mm-hmm. But over time, millions of years in this planet Earth, there was a war where there would be a volcano, earthquake, and the land that was inside the core would rise up.
Rise up, sure.
The water would take it over again. John G. Jackson, great African scholar, says that happened about 5 or 6 times. We don't know how many times. Mm-hmm. But we do know that at one point, that hill that came up remained up. The water never overtook it again. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So that this hill that rose up out the waters would then have the sunlight come down and hit that top of the hill. That top of the hill geographically was what we today call the continent of Africa. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. All the other parts of the hill as it cascaded down were all the other continents. Because of the earthly events on this hill, they began to separate. Mm-hmm. They began to divide themselves. They began to have different things happen to them. And that's what we call the continental divide or the shift of this one mass planet that we call Pangaea, which our ancestors call Ptah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. One of the events that happened in the central part of the hill that we call Africa was a split that's called the Rift Valley. Geographically, that Rift Valley today exists from Mozambique. It goes straight up through at the east coast of Africa. It goes into the Red Sea and into what we today call Israel. Yesterday, we called it Palestine. The day before it was Palestine, it was the African land known as Canaan. Okay. Inside this Rift Valley, what happened is that there was another rift. This rift, we today, our ancestors, well, we today call it the Nile River. So inside the Rift Valley, there's the Nile Valley. Water cascaded down. Remember, water cascaded down into this valley, and that's what created what we today call the Nile River. And this river flowed straight up, but it didn't go into what we today call Egypt. Mm. So what actually occurred was that in Ethiopia, there was a lake and a river, Lake Tana and the Atbara River, A-T-B-A-R-A, Atbara, Atbara. Some people call it A-T-A-B-A-R-A. That's the river. The lake is Tana, T-A-N-A. In the hills of Ethiopia, in this lake and in this river, there is deep, fertile land that we today, by the way, in the health food industry, we call it spirulina. Mm. This blue-green algae that is on the banks of these of Ethiopia. Now, because the water of Lake Tana and the river Atbara comes down at such a force, this Nile River would have ended in what we today call in Sudan, Khartoum. It would have ended there. It would have just meandered and ended in Khartoum. But because there is this system, this blue river, this blue Hapi, this blue Nile. See, Africans called it Hapi. They didn't call it the Nile. They called it Hapi. And because of this blue Hapi, this blue Nile, coming down and forcefully meeting the white Nile at Khartoum, it pushed it up and continued up into what we today call the Mediterranean Sea. Mm. And for millions of years, every time that river would come. Now, here's another piece that's going to lead to why I made the oil. Dr. Ben used to always tell us about the fact that any river that originates south of the equator flows from south to north. Any river who has its origins north of the equator flow north to south. When we as humans talk about where we're going, we say we're going down south. Mm. Yo, I'm going up north. But to our ancestors, they went down north and mm-hmm. up south. Mm-hmm. Because your reference to your direction flows with the river. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So you're going down the Mississippi and you're traveling south. But in fact, you're going down north on the Hapi River because you're traveling from south to north, because the flow of the river, because of its origins south of the equator, the Hapi, the Nile, flows from south to north. And so in this dynamic Rift Valley, Nile Valley, Nile River, in its origins in what we today call Kenya, Uganda, Tanzania, the northern part of southern Africa, and the eastern coast, or I shouldn't say coast, the eastern side of the Congo, this huge area is where the human family first originated. And it is in the papyrus of Hunefer, and in the papyrus of Turin, and there are other ones also that will tell you that Africans had written in Kemet in Egypt that they originated at the foothills of the mountains of the moon, where the god Hapi dwells. And what's interesting is that many times the head of Hapi, they say, is a baboon. I think it's the head of a primate. Because you really can't differentiate. It's interesting how Hapi's head part, its body part, is that of what we could call a primate, which is very interesting. But that's just another phenomenon that much more research has to go in to see exactly if our ancestors had the type of information then that we now have today. So that maybe Sheikh Anta Diop in his genius did not actually create something. It actually just recreated what was already created, as Shabaka on the Shabaka stone did not create the Shabaka stone. He literally just rewrote the Memphite text on stone,
right,
paying homage to the ancestors. But right, be that as it may, this is why the Hapi River is so important. Now, the other thing that my research is showing me, and it has been discussed before, is that over millions of years, rivers can be taken over by land, as we've seen. In the ancient world, when the early humans existed, the rivers of Africa were connected by tributaries. So it is very possible that the Hapi River, Nile River, was connected to the Congo River, was connected to the Limpopo River of southern Africa, was connected to the Niger River, was connected to the Benue River, to many of the great river systems of Africa, so that humans could have had uninterrupted travel throughout the continent by the river system. But the major river system, when you're looking at the Hapi, you have the Limpopo in the south, you have the Hapi that's traveling south to north, and you have the Congo River, you have the Niger River. So you have the opportunity at that point, if they're all connected, see, things could get cut off now. Land could take over, and what was once river, because we know from a satellite in space that there was a Taman Raset River that is now under the Sahara Desert. Satellites now can take pictures of the underground that can literally see the riverbeds under the Sahara Desert. And so that, because of what's called it's called the African humid phase and the African arid phase. Arid means that it's dry, and humid means that it's wet. In the early days, AHP was what dominated Northwest Africa, which would have allowed this river to exist. But with the movement of the dunes and the sands from east to west in North Africa, it covered up the river, and there's evidence of it off the coast of West Africa in what's called the Timorous Canyons. That underground show that the same sands that are in the most eastern part of Africa can be found in the riverbeds off the coast of West Africa. Science. So that this Hapi River becomes important, because we look at the word economy. We look at the word ecology. logi, the study of. Echo is comes from a Greek word, oikos, O-I-K-O-S. Oikos means environment or your home. So that economy, to know your economy, to know your surroundings, to know your home, means that because agriculture was so important to the human family, their economy was based on agriculture. And so many of the things they would produce, including the pyramids, would have something to do with the study of the heavens and the earth to be able to have a better agricultural science, because the better you eat, the better you think, the better you live, the better you eat, the better you... So that better than is based on agriculture. But basically, because the better you eat, the better you think, the better you think, the better you live. The better you live, the better you eat, the better you... Okay? So that's the concept.
Sure, sure. Wow.
So, that is the basis for the importance of Hapi. It was the river that brought forward happiness to the human family. It brought forward all that rich blue-green algae from the Blue Nile in Ethiopia, from those mountains down. It is what hit that white river, a white Hapi, where it meandered into Khartoum. It hit it and forced it to move north. That would later go up into the Mediterranean and then draw back. And as it would go out and draw back, more and more of the fertile lands would remain north. More after millions of years, that is what created what we today call Egypt. That is why they say that Egypt is the gift of the Nile.
Mm.
You know, when you stand on a beach and you're standing at the edge and the wave comes in and then it goes out, you feel like you're being brought out?
Yeah, yeah.
And then when it comes in, it feels like, well, that over millions of years, if you stood on that beach, you eventually, you know, would find very interesting things that go on. And now with all of these very heavy rains and all these floods, people now that are losing their beaches, that yeah. their beachfronts yeah. are being, well, that's what happened in Egypt over millions of years.
Sure.
Science. It's just about a matter of studying science, geology and anthropology and all sorts of different things that we need to study in order to why these things were important and why the Hapi River was so important to the human family. And why did they call it Hapi?
Why did they
call it Hapi? And where did that word Hapi come from?
Yeah. Talk to us about that.
You see? And so I first went to Egypt in 1983 to study. And then I returned in 1987. And when I went back in 1987, I was just so impacted because there were things that I knew I had to look for on my trip to Hapi in 87 that I didn't know about in 1983, particularly the Temple in Man, the book, The Temple in Man by Shuala de Lubitz, and the phenomenal structure, archaeological structure, the architectural structure known as the Grand Lodge of Luxor. Or the Ipet, and its relative temple that's called Karnak, or the Ipet Isut. Ipet means the holy place, and Ipet Isut means the holiest place. So I came back, and I spent more time on the Hapi. I was on the river for quite a while because I understood the importance of it, and I watched the flow of it from Aswan going straight up to Cairo. And I came back and I was just so excited. I was the director of social studies for my district in Community School District 9 in the Bronx. And I developed the social sciences for grades K through 8. And one of the things I've always enjoyed was teaching. I've always enjoyed teaching. I've never lost my love of teaching, even though I was an administrator. I always enjoyed my love of teaching. And so I decided that I wanted to go to my first grade classes because I was going to a lot of first grade classes. And I decided to teach about the south to north flow of this river. And so I started teaching and I went to my first grade class. After I came back, this is like October of 1987, And I went back and I started teaching. But I said, I want to do something creative. I want to do something inventive. And so in deciding to teach about this river, this Hapi River, I knew that there were brothers that were street vendors that sold oils. And so I went to the brother and he told me where to go to get the oil. So I went and I got some oils. And I went back to the class and I began to teach the class. And I had a certain amount of oil, not much, but I would pour out the river that represented the White Nile. And I said, here's the White Nile. I had my map and I had everything in place. It was there. But I would just pour a certain amount of the, I said, this is the White Nile. And I would pour the White Nile in. And then I would take the Blue Nile and I would pour that in, talking about Ethiopia. Mm. And then I had a special oil that I created that was meant to represent the richness and the power of the energy of the Blue Nile. That I first put in the Blue Nile oil to talk about that energy and that power. I called it Ra. I'm with first graders now. Mm-hmm. I'm with people who are at the end of 5-year-old, 6-year-old, 7-year-old. The class of about, give or take, no more than 30 students. They're just looking up at this. They're saying, I guess in their heads. They say, where are we going with this? But the one thing I've learned about being with children is that you have to be very creative in what you do. You just can't just sit there and lecture them.
Right.
You got to get them physically involved. You've got to get them mentally involved. You have to touch all of their senses, their eyes, their nose, their taste, their feelings, everything, right? And so I was ending the class. And I was leaving, and one of the students said, well, Brother Booker T, because that was my name then, Booker T, Brother Booker T, can we smell the oil? And I never thought about that. My first intention was simply to demonstrate the development of the Hapi, to have the children be able, because even now when I talk about down north and up south, I literally have to change the way I'm thinking to say it. Because I'm so used to saying down south and up north.
Sure.
So I wanted to introduce into these young minds their ability to do it from a very young age. I wanted them to reorient themselves. I wanted them to reorientate themselves as Africans looked at the world. They didn't look at the world from north to south. That's a European perspective. Mm-hmm. I wanted them to be able to, in whatever way they could, for the moments they could, view the world from south to north. And to do that, you got to get them young before they've said down south enough times. Mm-hmm. And so this class allowed me. And so one of the young brothers said, can we smell the oil? And so I said, wow, okay, I never thought about that before. But I didn't want to say no. So on my way out, everybody lined up and I had them, I put a little dab on their inside wrist. And I told them, go like that. And they smelled. I said, ooh, that's nice. And so, okay. So then I go to my next school or my next assignment that I'm teaching or that I'm developing staff development for the staff or I'm talking to parents because that basically was my job as director. So the next week, I go back to the school. And as I'm going to the school, the young brother comes up to me and say, Brother Booker T, my mother says she wants some of that oil. And I said, okay. I said, well, young brother, tell mom I don't make oil. I just did that to teach you about the river. He said, yeah, but my mother, when I get home, my mother liked that oil. She was smelling me all night long. In fact, she came next to her, she kept smelling me. And then when her friends came over, she said, smell that boy. His teacher was teaching him something about some river there in Africa, and I'm smell that boy. And then he said his mother, when he got up the next morning, mother smelled him again to see if it lasted overnight. I said, well, tell mom I don't. He said, yeah, but my mother really liked that oil, Brother Booker T. I said, well, tell mom. Okay, so I go to the second class, I teach that class, and now I go and I do my thing. I come back the third week, now mother is in the school.
Uh-oh.
And uh-oh, one of her friends was one of the mothers of my second class. See, this is how stuff lines up for you that you never realize.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I tell this story in many different ways, but I also tell the story as it relates to entrepreneurial skills.
Mm-hmm.
Because when your heart is pure and when you do things for what could be considered the right reasons, gifts will be given to you that you don't realize.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I never did this oil as a money-making venture.
Mm-hmm.
That was never in my mind. It was a teaching tool for children.
Mm-hmm.
Needless to say, mother comes to me and she says, "Brother Booker T, I got to get some of that oil." She said, I use oil. She said, "I know oil. I use oil. I don't use the colognes and the perfumes and all that. I only use oil. And I buy from the brothers and sisters in the street, but I ain't never smelled nothing like this before."
Mm-hmm.
And I said, "Well, you know, my sister, I don't make oil. And you know, sisters, when you cock your head to the side, you know, like, yo, brother, did you hear what I say?" Sister gave me $10. You know, she said, "Brother, please make me some of that oil." She said, "What you call it?" I said, "I call it Hapi." And then I began to think. I said, "No, I'm going to call it Hapi in Kush." And so that day, the third week of this experience, was when it got a name. I called it into being. I called it Hapi in Kush. Up until then, the oil didn't have a name. It was just teaching about Hapi River.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
The third week was when it got a name. It was now brought into being. It was Hapi in Kush. Now, needless to say, when you're living in the Bronx, when you're living amongst our people, one of the things we learn amongst us is you don't send memorandums through the grapevine. You know, Gladys Knight and the Pips and Marvin Gaye, they got a song, "I Heard It in the Grapevine."
That's right. That's right.
Okay. So what happened after that third visit, and I made that oil for the mother, and I made another bottle for, well, I didn't make the bottle. The sister shared the other bottle with the other mother from the second week. Through the grapevine in the South Bronx, in what we call South Central Bronx, in my district, in the grapevine, the word got out that there is an oil called Hapi, and you got to get it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And that became an economical advantage. Now I sell that oil in the African communities of Holland. I sell it in London. I sell it in the Caribbean. I sell it all around the country. This has become a gift to me. But it was a gift from the children.
Yep, absolutely.
It was from my first graders, because if that young brother had not asked to smell it in that first class, I would never have dabbed it on him.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I was packing up ready to go. Mm-hmm. I might have just put that somewhere in my house, never used it, maybe used it. I don't know.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But what I do know is that young brother, in his excitement now to smell Hapi in Kush, brought that smell home. Mother smelt it and wanted some. And out of that, sequences of events came that river that people will find on my site called Hapi in Kush. That's how it evolved. Now, let's go back to the concept of Hapi and the importance of the environment. Uh-huh. I used my environment, uh-huh, knowing my environment, going to the brothers and sisters that sold oil in the community, them telling me where to get the oil from, my getting it, my developing it, was a knowledge of my environment.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
I knew my environment. When I said I want to do something different, I thought of oil. I knew the brother on 161st Street that was outside the mall that sold the oil. I knew him. I knew where he was. You see, so that the idea of economy is very important for us to know your environment, to know your home, and to be able to utilize it to your best effect, to be able to draw a wealth that allows you to move forward and to move your community forward, to move your family forward, to move your friends forward, and not alien beings that are parasitically attaching themselves to your home wealth.
I love that. Love that.
And so that's the story of Hapi and the smell that comes forward. And as I used to always give a sample to all of my college at the end, the last day of school, of classes in my college class, I gave everybody a sample. And in the beginning of the class, I told them, I want you to just take it out and I want you to dab a little bit and I want you to just rub it and I want you to smell it. And of course they would go ahead and do that. And then I would tell them the story I just told you. And then I would wrap up the 15 weeks that we had been together and what I hoped they had gotten from the class and how much I appreciated and respected their coming to class and taking my class and how much I learned from them. And I then, in between all of that 2.5 hours of class, I would periodically tell them, I want you to take another smell. And they would take a smell of the oil and they would go back. And then I would keep talking. And then maybe another half hour, 20 minutes later, I would tell them, take another smell, and they smell. And I would explain to them the importance of understanding sensuality and the importance of sensuality.
Mm.
And I would explain to them the understanding of how it is that
did we lose you there, Professor? Yeah, it froze on me there. Okay, let's see what's going on here. All right, hold on, ladies and gentlemen. Let's see what happens. Okay, there we go. Sorry about that, ladies and gentlemen. Technical difficulties with Wi-Fi. Professor Kaba is coming back on. I have him on the phone now. And he should be popping back up here any moment. And for those who are watching live, by the way, there's a link below if you want to get the Hapi oils from Professor Kaba at a special rate. It's absolutely amazing. I've been using it now for probably about 2 years, and it's just absolutely incredible. There's no other scent or fragrance like it. And for those of you who already have the Hapi oil, you know exactly what I'm talking about. How you doing, Professor? Okay. You always know when you're doing good stuff, you're going to have a technical gaffe every now and again. Yeah. Professor is saying what we're talking about is so powerful, the energy system, you know, sometimes that it gets, you know, it overflows. It's like a circuit breaker. It's just too much. And I totally get that. I totally understand that. If you are truly into this level of work, this level of liberation, I haven't done a show on it yet, but I can tell you story after story about all of the things that have tried to stop me from doing it. There we go. Turn the phone off and get the echo out of there. I was saying, Professor, you know, when you're doing this type of work, this level of work, we don't talk about it on the air that much, but there's so much sabotage that occurs when you start telling the truth. It's kind of funny because I sent to you and a few other people, you know, the FBI has basically started looking at people who ascribe and subscribe to black identity. And there's this whole new thing about black identity and trying to take people who have a black identity, who wants to talk about black liberation, and put them on a list. And when I look at that, some people get angry and upset about it. I actually start cheering because I know that means we are getting close to that promised land. The only time that that occurs is when you are doing the right thing, and it is, the knowledge is becoming critical mass, and there's nothing that they can do to stop it. It's like what you told us many times before, in what Minister Farrakhan said, the internet was created for us. And all these films, documentaries, all of these shows, internet-based shows that continually bring great knowledge, great wisdom, and everybody starts connecting the dots with all of this information, and our consciousness collectively begins to rise and grow. As I said, the war will not be fought on the ground, it'll be fought in the air, and that means in consciousness. And so as our consciousness collectively raises, Dr. Wade Nobles yesterday on my show said something very profound. Of course, everything he said was profound, as you know. Absolutely. But he said something, and I'm going to paraphrase because I know I'm not going to be able to quote him directly. But he said something to the effect of, he might have been quoting Minister Farrakhan when he says that when you go into a dark room and you turn on the light, the darkness knows what to do, so he used that as a metaphor to say, when you turn on the light, raising consciousness, white supremacy knows exactly what to do, and it can't manifest its reality, because you're going to shed that blackness on it, you're going to put that black light on it, and that's it. And that's really where we are going, rapidly growing in consciousness. And I think that's why you know, we've done shows on frequency. Let's talk about this, Professor, if you could. Talk about the frequency of scent, the frequency of smell. Yes. Because all of that is part, those olfactory glands and all of that is part of my ritual to increase my melanin and to create that shield, that buffer, from the racial battle fatigue that I deal with every day, that we all deal with every day. But I think it's important to maybe just talk about kind of what, you know, why are we talking about this? Why are we talking about an oil? We're talking about frequency and raising frequency. Let's really get into it and talk about, because we're on an assault. So what do you do? I get up in the morning after I take my shower and all of that. And well, I don't shave anymore, as you can see, just the top and under here. That's it. And I put on my Hapi oil. I listen to my binaural beats and solfeggio frequencies and get my sound and vibration working. All of that is part of the armor before I go out and deal with the oppression, the micro and macroaggressions of the day. Talk to us about that, Professor.
Well, and in fact, I believe where I was cut off was where I was heading in that direction.
Mm-hmm.
When I was cut off, I was talking about what I tell my college students that last day of class. When I have them put the oil on, and I tell them, now for the past 15 sessions, your eyes have captured my physical appearance. You've captured everything that's in this room. You have created images that you have locked into your memory, and you'll never forget. You and I will see each other 50 years from now.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and that memory of me that you've seen for 15 weeks will come back. You'll know me, and I will know you.
Mm-hmm.
I may be in a room off to the side, and I may be talking. You may not be able to see me, but you will hear my voice that you've been listening to for the past 15 weeks. You know my voice. You know people who have asked questions. You know what their voice sounds like. Your ears, your oral, A-U-R-A-L, your oral tradition has now memorized and has put into your memory bank what those sounds are. I said, if we have shaken hands, or if I've given you something where you have felt my touch as it relates to giving you something, or if we've shaken hands, or if we've done whatever it was, you now have a sense of touch, mm-hmm, in your memory bank. Okay, so that now you smell me.
Mm-hmm.
Now you know my smell,
mm-hmm,
because Hapi and Kush is my smell.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And the whole time I had them smelling it, what I was doing is I was having them register that memory of the smell,
mm-hmm,
in their olfactory memory. So that years from now, if they never even get a sample of this again, but somebody should purchase my oil where they're around, they'll say, wow, that smells like,
exactly,
Professor Kaba.
Exactly, exactly.
For we as humans, the sense of smell was probably the first sensory perception we heightened.
Mm-hmm.
Because you may not have seen that lion, but you certainly could smell him. So you had to make sure that your olfactory ability to smell was one of the first things, because there's a lot of things you may not see,
mm-hmm,
first.
Mm-hmm. Or hear.
Or hear, that's exactly right.
Yeah.
So that your smell is one of the areas that is most sensual to us.
Mm-hmm.
It creates a condition, as you say, when you wake up and you do your ablutions and you do all the things you do early in the morning. You get your coffee in place, okay? But then you put your Hapi, and then you listen to the beats. What you just described are all the sensual perceptions that you create in your life in order to go out and deal with the real world.
Mm-hmm.
And so the oil that I created, because it comes from children, is so special to me. That is why I keep it at a price that our people can afford it. I don't get ridiculous.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because I don't want to put it out there like that. I don't want to make it a money-making venture.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I want to make it reachable for our people to be able to get that, a sensation, so that those things that they experience. And even to this day, now I taught college, I taught that class for from the fall of 2004 until the spring of 2016.
Mm-hmm.
I was in my 13th year of teaching, and I have met people who graduated that will tell me. I have people now, students that order the oil.
Mm-hmm.
And they say, I mean, since I had that, and that came from just that sample bottle. I've had students contact me almost a year later and say that they were just at the end of that sample bottle, that they just use a little tip of it. They say, because I didn't want to lose it.
It's crack cocaine for your nose. I swear to God, it is something. It's, you cannot stop smelling it. It's really interesting how viral it is. And I guess sensuous is the word, that, you know, you just, you know, part of, and I'll talk about this in my book, Digital Nomics, in terms of frequency specificity and using frequency to raise your melanin, and to set that armor, that spiritual, invisible armor. Sometimes that when there's a microaggression or even a macroaggression that you're affronted with in your day, and you can't verbally react to it, you can't physically react to it, what do you do to calm yourself, to recenter yourself, to reinitiate that original frequency of the pyramid builders? And for me, it's just simply, you know, I might, you know, make it look like I'm looking at my watch or adjusting something, and it's just taking in that aroma. And that aroma calms me down, it centers me, and it's part of my ability to handle all of the white fragility that is hitting me in the course of my day. And it's all relative, and so I'm not going to get into a contest of, you know, who gets more white fragility than not. We all get it. But in terms of the type of work that I do, the type of work that you do, we probably get it more frequently and more viciously than most. I mean, some of my white guests who are historians, that are, you know, like even Dr. Jacqueline Battalore, Dr. Robin DiAngelo, I mean, to the point of getting death threats, which has now become normal part of our lives. You have to have something that brings you back and centers you and reconnects you immediately to your frequency. And so sometimes you can't put on some binaural beats. Sometimes you can't vocalize something, but I can always instantly get back to that frequency the moment I smell it. And these are the little, you know, aspects of frequency specificity that we can begin using to buffer ourselves and prepare ourselves for that white fragility impact. So I just wanted to kind of share that part with my family, because we really don't have time to, we have never done a show like this. We've never talked about that type of frequency, how to apply frequency, how to raise frequency, how to keep that melanin charged throughout the day. I think that is something that, you know, we're going to deal with deeper as we start to launch this Comedic Metaphysical Wisdom School, you know, coming the first of the year. But it's important that we have our spiritual armor on and prepare ourselves for the day ahead, for the week ahead, for the month ahead. And so that's what Hapi and Kush oil means to me and gives me on a daily basis.
And I, you know, what's interesting again is the gift. And it also goes back to the price that I ask, because of the nature of that it was a gift. And you never abuse a gift from the Creator.
Mm-hmm.
And every time I smell Hapi, I smell the future, because it was given to me from my future, who were the children.
Mm.
See, that's for me the most important thing I could ever say. This was a gift to me from children, from children who in 1987, you're talking about 30 years ago, so they're upwards close going on to their 40s right now.
Wow.
But back then when they were 5 and 6 years of age, back in 1987, they were pure, they were wonderful, they were exploring. And so that smell, like I say, that the idea of your olfactory bulb, you know, located right in the vicinity of your olfactory bulb, when we spoke earlier about the Grand Lodge of Luxor, the Ipet.
Mm-hmm.
The Ipet was created in the direct proportions of the human body. Now this spans city blocks, this mm-hmm. temple. But the way in which it was constructed, it literally was constructed according to the canon, according to the development of a human body.
Mm-hmm.
And when you go into the temple, as you go through the different sections of this temple, the Grand Lodge of Luxor, the way in which you know it was about the human body is that as you move through the temple, it explains what part of the body you'd be in at that point.
Wow.
When you get to the Holy of Holies, which is in the southern part of the temple, the Holy of Holies, you get to a structure that's created that is divided into rooms, as you read this book, The Temple and Man by Schwalla de Lubitz, or you could go to YouTube to a 8-part series called Magical Egypt, and go to segment 4, where they show you this temple
mm-hmm.
and how it's divided. When you get to the Holy of Holies, you get into the area that is known as the third into the third ventricle, and that is where the pineal gland is. But if I can just say it this way, in room 5 and room 12, room 5 and room 12 are next to each other.
Mm.
Room 5 and room 12, in their connection, literally is connected in more than one way, because that's where your olfactory bulb and your smelling is, so that when you smell, the air goes in here, but it travels back. The same way in room 5 and room 12 is connected, because as you move from one, you go into the other. It's a phenomenal building. I've been there. In fact, I slept overnight in it in 1987.
Wow.
Because I didn't know its importance the first time I went in 83. I read the book Temple and Man when I was studying with Dr. Van Sertima in Mexico the following year in 84. And I said, I got to go back.
Wow.
So in 1987, in fact, I had one of those military flashlights. It it was green and it had the head. It wasn't a flashlight that flashed straight. It turned right. up.
Okay.
And you could use it like this, right? And so the brother that was the guard outside the temple, I said, well, what can I give you? Bakshish, which is like money. He looked at that flashlight. He said, no, tomorrow morning I want that flashlight. So I said, it's yours. Okay. So that's how I get to stay overnight. But I said, I can't give it to you now because I need the flashlight because I need to do some research tonight.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So, and I had brought the flashlight specifically for the Grand Lodge. So I got what I needed done, and I did the research in that temple. But what's important is that in the olfactory, right in that part of the temple, there is a part of the body that our ancient Kemetic ancestors called the Shittite Nfint, S-H-Y-T-Y-T. Second word is N-T. Third word is F-N-D, Shittite Nfint. I have a curriculum on this part of the brain.
Mm.
This area, the Shittite Nfint, located near your olfactory bulb, which tells you the importance of smell, is where all of your senses meet in one area, where your eyes, where your eye, where your nose, your taste, your hearing, and your sensations all meet in this one area, your five senses, right near the pineal gland. Now, when you meditate, and this is what I do with folk, you talk about having to deal with the world that you're going out into.
Yes.
What we have learned is that the letter M in Meduneta is symbolized by the owl. Now, why would the owl be the symbol for the sound The letter M is the only sound we make where our mouth has to be closed completely. Ba, ka, because vowels and consonants, vowels are not important. The only reason why we have vowels is to separate the hard sounds of the consonants in sound. So, you know, we could not really pronounce a word that said BB. So we put A in the middle and BAB. Or pop, or top. The vowel is meant to separate the consonants, the hard sound, because our mouths can't pronounce that. So the consonant sound is the only sound we make where our mouth has to be closed completely. And in that, we create vibration within our body. That's why, that's why words like mama, Muhammad, many sacred sounds come from the sound M. Okay? And I always tell people, you don't believe me? Okay, check this out. What do you say when food tastes good? You say, Okay? What do you say when you get a good idea? Because all of those vibrate. When grandma had a problem, and she went into her rocking chair. What did she start to do? She started to hum.
Well, what I'm doing right now, like even affirmation, just affirming what you're saying is
Yeah.
And that's just, that's, you know, how amazing is that, that we are just divinely connected to source and frequency. And we think we're separate, but we're not. We're never separate from that frequency.
Absolutely.
But everything else around us tries to make us feel like we're separated.
Well, that's the Seethian forces trying to separate you from your God quality. Some of us give in, but some of us refuse. But you see, when you make that sound, when you make that sound, the Shittite infant, which is right there, is vibrating in a pool of melanin. And that's what draws you down into nirvana. That's what draws you down into the Nun, the origins of the waters of Nun. This is where it draws you down, so that when you speak about having a problem during your day, when you talk about what we as Black folk have to face, or as women have to face, or as any other person that stands out in the mind of white fragility that we have to deal with every day. If you just went off and just hummed, it would take you down and it would relax you.
Well, think about what our ancestors did in slavery.
Yes.
Think about that. Yes. You know, that was in many ways the only thing they could do, because some of them were in situations where they could not speak.
That's right. So they would sing. And that's where song became so important. That's where vocality, the song, whether people realize it or not, they literally were bathing their souls with the waters of God, the Creator, the Spirit, when they were thrown in a cesspool of white fragility. This is how they bathed themselves. And this is how they could come forward stronger than they were when they were being treated that way. And here we are, their children, their children's children, wondering how do we handle this? You spoke earlier about being on a list. If you stand up and believe, we have to understand that we are the most powerful entity in the world. I don't like to talk superiority, inferiority. Being African don't make me superior. But because of my Africanity and being treated the way I have historically, epigenetically, throughout my existence in America, what did not kill me made me stronger.
That's right. That's right.
And you have created a superior being by the way in which you've treated me and everyone else that has had to go through this day in and day out.
That's right.
You made me superior to you. I wasn't born this way. I became this way because I had to find ways to be able to go beyond your level of superficiality and your intellectual impotence and your scholastic sterility. Not speaking to everybody. I'm speaking to the guilty. I'm speaking to the ones that do this.
Absolutely.
And what we have to do as a people is to bathe ourselves and to put our armor on. And we have to understand what our ancestors did that allowed them to go. And so when they were basking in the heat of the sun, picking cotton, and they started singing, they weren't happy. But having them sing made up for the pain that they felt. And that made them happy.
It connected them to that frequency of the Nile Valley River.
Absolutely. Because they what? They understood their environment or their oikos, and they took advantage of it. And they knew that their voice would help them get through the process.
Wow.
And they created ointments. And in the Caribbean, where plants were so plentiful, they created ointments that would be like Hapi and Kush. That allowed them to put it on their bodies or put it around their face where they could smell it so they could deal with the horrors of what they experienced.
So what I'm going to do, never done this before, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to let's do a test, if you will. I'm getting ready to reorder. It's about time for me to reorder my Hapi and Kush oil. So I'm going to reorder my Hapi and Kush oil. Let's do a 30-day frequency and vibration process. And what we'll do is we'll communicate. Some of you are on our Facebook pages. YouTube just had just launched a new community section on the channel, so we can connect that way and just kind of talk about how we're going to use our Hapi and Kush oil for 30 days every day and see how I, particularly for those who have not tried it. I think that's the people I really want to talk to, and see how that frequency is manifesting for you. How is it buffering the white fragility, the frequency of the European? How is the Hapi and Kush, the olfactory sensory glands, how is that buffering for you? And so let's take that 30-day test. There's a link below for you to get the oil from Professor Kaba. And you know, when I think about it, I get emotional because it's crazy how we can connect to that frequency of the children that created this oil, because technically they did it. They, you know, Professor Kaba was the vessel to pull it together. But you know, that frequency of the child from the Nile, if you will, is what created this. And by smelling that scent, it connects you to that frequency of the Nile, and it connects you to home. It connects you to that center, so you know that you are not alone, that in that moment when you inhale, all the ancestors and the strength of all the ancestors come in and shield you and guard you and hold you and protect you and love you. That's what I want to talk about. I want us to have a dialogue back and forth about this for the next 30 days. And so, Professor, if you could, I don't know if you're able to, but I think something also that helps again with frequency specificity is that when you ship these oils out, maybe you could have an autograph of something that you can sign or something, just to have that frequency to see something that, again, it's all of these things that create sensories. You know, Gagu, we haven't talked about, we're getting ready to do another series on Gagu. Having that image of Gagu, that equation, and maybe that's something we can do here, have that equation, have that scent, and connect it back to source, and look at all of those sensories, all of our five senses, and what can we do that we can just create a center location, a zero point, to get back to our original frequency and manifest that throughout our day. Let's do that as a 30-day challenge together, and see where we. So we'll pick up where we left off 30 days from now and have a conversation about it. What do you think?
I think that's fantastic. And my brother Philippe, I'd also like to ask the community, and I realize that some folk may be watching this because during the day right now, it's 2:25, almost 2:30 in the afternoon. I realize some people may be watching this in a place where they cannot do what I'm about to ask them to do. But this is what I always, when I'm demonstrating, because you see, everything connects with me scientifically, which means knowledge and wisdom. I don't connect emotionally. Frequency to me is not an emotion. Mm-hmm. Vibration is not an emotion. It's a science to me. And so what I do with our students and anyone that listens that I get into this conversation with, I always have them ask them, you know, some like to close their eyes, some don't like to close their eyes. To me, it doesn't make a difference. The reason why you close your eyes is because I want you to go down into the blackness within yourself. So when you cannot see, there's no lights, there's nothing around you. But what I ask them to do is I ask them on the count of three, and I always tell them I'm going to count in Kiswahili, Moja Mbili Tatu, because let's get African if we're going to do this. Moja Mbili Tatu. And on Tatu, which is three, I want you to perform the sound. And I tell them, while you're making that sound, I want you to search in your head where you feel a tickling sensation. And so then I say, let's do it again. I say, Moja Mbili Tatu. And then they say, And they search for the area that's tickling. I have them do it a third time. And then I tell them, because for some people, you can't do it right away. You can't feel it right away. There are so many things going on. It's new to you. You may be in an unsettled place, because in the classroom, some people don't want to open themselves up to such vulnerability. Mm-hmm. So they don't do it. But in their own dorm rooms, or when they go back home, or wherever I may be doing it, when you get private and you go, search for the area that you feel a tickling sensation. And in that location is where your shittite infant is located. That's mm-hmm. how you can locate your shittite infant in your brain. Mm-hmm. Because what's tickling is that vibration is literally vibrating your shittite infant. And it's literally a tickling sensation. But that tickling sensation, you have to imagine standing in a pool of blackness, a pool of melanin. That's why I have them close their eyes. So you can see that blackness, and that you're meditating in it, and that the waters are just vibrating around you. So your shittite infant becomes you. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And you feel a calming sensation. It brings you to a certain level. And so the oil is not a magical oil. And so I don't want to come to our people with a concept that this is magic. It ain't magic. It's science. Mm-hmm. I've put together a pleasant aroma that when it reaches back into your olfactory bulb, it allows you to enjoy your space for that moment. Mm-hmm. That's what all smells do. Mm-hmm. It allows you to enjoy the space that you're in. It's no magic. You are the magic. What you bring to it is your magic. And you cast aside the demons of your day. You cast aside, because there's no place for them in the shittite infant. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. They can't live there. They're not allowed there. They're not in the Holy of Holies. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Evil is not allowed in your Holy of Holies. But if you don't identify your Holy of Holies, if you don't know that it exists, then the devil can permeate your body and you don't even know you have a Holy of Holies.
Mm-hmm. How about that?
When you go into a church, the Holy of Holies is called the sanctuary. And we have Holy of Holies. And in the Temple of Man, in the Grand Lodge of Luxor, that is what it was meant, that you were a walking temple.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that in your pineal gland, in your third ventricle, you have three major glands. You have your pituitary gland, your pineal gland, and your optic thalami. Your pituitary gland is responsible for your physical growth. Your optic thalami is responsible for your emotional and soulful growth. And your pineal gland is responsible for your spiritual growth. And in that trinity, in that area, it vibrates. And when our ancestors talked about sacred science, this is what they were talking about. They were not talking about this outside world of hocus pocus. They were talking about the miracle, in fact, is you and what the potential is in you. So the Hapi oil was meant to create a pleasant aroma that allowed you to enjoy the space that you were in, to allow you to get to that point in your life where the demonic forces weren't allowed. Mm-hmm. And by demonic forces, I'm not talking about no devil and all the rest of that. Mm-hmm. I'm talking mm-hmm. about principalities of evil.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I'm talking about things that make us sad
mm-hmm.
and make us mad and mess up our day, because we were supposed to be in paradise. We were not supposed to be hell. Hell don't exist. Hell is what humans have created.
Mm-hmm.
And so we have to get back to it so we can solve our problems, particularly for our children. If we solved our problems, if we were able to solve our own problems, we could solve all problems outside. But you can only do it by example.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so what I'd like the community to do is to think in terms of in your alone space, in your safe space. During your day, when you've had a rough day in the office, and you're on the way to lunch, hum your way to lunch. Whatever your favorite song is, just hum it. Mm-hmm. Sam Cooke once said, what's the essence of soul? And he said, mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
That was his answer.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder if he understood what we just talked about.
I'm sure he did. I'm sure he did.
Deep inside of him.
Sure he did.
He hummed. And that's the essence of soul.
Yes.
It's amazing. I have his essential, the essential of Sam Cooke, great soul artist.
Mm-hmm.
And that was his answer. At the end, the interviewer asked him, Sam, what's the essence of soul? And he just,
wow. Well, that's how you end the conversation right there. That's absolutely fantastic, my brother. Thank you once again, Professor Kaba Hiawatha Kamene. Go to the link below to get the copy in Hush Oil. You can also go to kabakamene.com and sign up for Spirituality Before Religion. Download the free e-course if you have not done so. 5-day e-course from Professor Kaba. Absolutely amazing. And there's some other links below to connect with other aspects of Professor Kaba and what he is bringing to the world. I just adore you. You're my John Henry Clark of this generation. So I just so appreciate you, brother, for the spirit that you bring. And we'll see you guys next time on the Philippe Matthews Show Live. Stick around with me, Professor, in the green room as we sign off.
Hotep family. Hotep family.